Hi, my name is Gabe. I'm a mathematician and a tutor, and I'm excited to dive into some statistics with you all today. Today's focus will be on normal random variables, one of the most important concepts in all statistics. We will start by defining and describing what qualitative properties lead to a normal random variable. We will then discuss the mathematical properties of normal random variables, providing some mathematical language for their general characteristics. Finally, we will discuss how to work with the normal distribution, particularly understanding how its symmetries are useful and how to use its tabular representations to find cumulative probabilities. Normal random variables come up often when it comes to sizing products for a diverse population. Having a proper inventory of products of the right sizes will ensure that you can match customer needs, but how can you predict what products to order? For example, a shoe store may be looking to stock a new shoe, and they have to know how many of each size to order. They know that most people need shoes somewhere in the range of the middle of the total possible size range, but some people, maybe basketball players, need huge shoes. At the same time, other people might have a smaller shoe size, but there probably aren't so many people who need the smallest shoe. A random variable that follows this sort of distribution, where a bulk of the observations are somewhere in the middle of the range, with some observations out toward the edge, can sometimes be modeled as a normal random variable. Normal random variables follow the classic bell curve distribution. Pictured above is the standard normal with a mean mu of 0 and a standard deviation sigma of 1. A majority of the observations occur close to the center, and there's a decreasing rate of observing outliers as those outliers get further from the center. These observations are continuous, and a normally distributed variable can take on any continuous value. It is important to emphasize that this particular distribution is referred to as the standard normal distribution when it has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. In other cases, a normal distribution with different parameters may also describe the random variable. In the case of shoe sizes, we can use one characterized by a mean of 10 and a standard deviation of 2. Notice how now the bell curve is centered at 10, and the distribution falls off towards the much bigger and much smaller shoe sizes. In general, the shape of the normal curve will always be the same, but its center will be impacted by its mean value, mu, while its width and height will be determined by the standard deviation, sigma. For example, the standard normal is pictured above in black, with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1, while the shoe size distribution is pictured in orange, with its mean of 10 and a standard deviation of 2. Notice how the peaks occur at 0 and 10 respectively, while the orange curve appears wider than the black curve. Definitionally, a normal random variable is a continuous random variable which exhibits a symmetric bell-shaped distribution and is fully defined by a mean and standard deviation. These features are mathematically significant for us and lead us to several important properties. First, let's focus on the symmetry of the normal curve. We should begin by reminding you that the sum over an entire range of a probability distribution has to be equal to 1. A normal variable, denoted as capital X, is continuous and can take on any value from negative infinity to positive infinity. And thus we should note that the probability of negative infinity less than the random variable x less than infinity is going to equal 1. As mentioned before, one of the key characteristics of the normal curve is that it is symmetric around the mean mu. That means that the function has the same shape to the left and the right of whatever the mean parameter is. Pause the video for a moment to see if this can tell us anything about the probability of seeing an observation either less than or greater than the mean is. Hopefully you were able to realize that if the probability curve is symmetric around the mean and you're equally likely to see either observation, then each observation has a 50% chance of happening. In this case, the purple and gray areas are both the same and are equal to 0.5. This is the first property to note about the symmetry of the normal curve. Another outcome of the symmetry of this distribution is that the probability of observing something that is shifted to the left of the mean by some constant d is going to be the same as the probability of observing something that is shifted by d to the right of the mean. This is a crucial fact when using normal distributions to calculate confidence intervals or perform hypothesis tests. Because of the ubiquity of the normal distribution, there are some useful values to remember for its probabilistic outcomes. In general, it can be nice to think about probabilities in terms of standard deviations. That is, we can talk about how unlikely an event is based on how many standard deviations away from the mean it is. Using the standard normal distribution shown above, the likelihood of observing an outcome from within a standard deviation of the mean, which we write as mu minus sigma less than or equal to x less than or equal to mu plus sigma, is roughly equal to 0.68. The probability of an outcome plus or minus 2 sigma is equal to approximately 0.95. Finally, an observation within 3 sigma of the mean is likely to happen 99.7% of the time. Of these three numbers, the 2 sigma deviation will come up the most frequently. There are just a few more rules that we should mention concerning how to calculate cumulative probabilities. These probabilities are always defined for less than operators. The rule number 1 enables to flip this definition. Therefore, we say that the probability of x being greater than a is equal to 1 minus the probability of x being less than a. We can do this because the total probability is just equal to 1. Rule 2 allows you to calculate the probability of x being between some range a and b is the probability of X being smaller than B, and then subtracting away the probability that X is less than A. For a problem like this, where we want to find the probability of observing something between negative 1, the value of A, and 1.5, the value of B, we would not necessarily be able to do this with a single less than equation. We have to construct this interval from the shaded area to the left of B, and then subtract the area to the left of A. This would give us the desired in-between interval. Finally, the third rule states that the probability of some outcome that is more than d units to the right of the mean is equal to the probability of seeing some event that is less than d units to the left of the mean. For example, the probability of some observation being less than negative 1 is the same as the probability of it being greater than positive 1. If you want to look up this value exactly, we need to reference a z table. Let's ask ourselves what the probability of seeing some value that is left of negative 1 is. To do this, we can reference a standard normal table. This is also called a z table. Z, in this case, refers to the lookup value of negative 1. To find the cumulative probability from negative infinity up to our critical z value, we find the row that refers to negative 1 all the way to the tens place, and then the column that has 0 in the thousands place. This gives us a value of approximately 0.159 for the cumulative probability that x is less than negative 1. For any value of z, including positive values, such a table will provide the cumulative probability that x is less than that value. The introduction of the z-score leads us to one more point. While the standard normal has easy lookup tables, in the case of real-world applications, our shoe store, for example, we don't have a z-table for that specific distribution. Standardized z-scores provide a translation between a generally normally distributed variable and the standard normal distribution. They do so through the following equation. The z-score of some value x for a normal distribution of the general mean mu and a standard deviation sigma is equal to the value minus the mean all divided by the standard deviation. With all this in mind, let's work through an example. Returning to our shoe store, let's still have that our mean is 10 and our standard deviation is 2. Let's also say that the shoe store wants to make sure that it can adequately serve a customer base of a shoe size greater than 13. What proportion of the population can we expect to be buying shoes that are greater than 13 inches big? The first step to answering this question is to find the appropriate z-score for the problem at hand. Our critical value is at x equals 13. We have the other terms necessary for our z-score calculation already. The necessary equation is z is equal to the quantity x minus mu divided by the standard deviation. Plugging in our numbers, we have that z equals the quantity 13 minus 10 divided by 2. This provides us a final z-score of 1.5. Coming back to our original visual, our z-score tells us that we can translate our calculation for the probability of x being greater than 13 on a normal distribution of mean 10 and sigma 2, the probability of the z-score being greater than 1.5 on a standard normal distribution. Finally, in order to get this probability out of a z-table, we must make use of our first cumulative probability rule and equate the probability of z being greater than 1.5 as 1 minus the probability of z being less than 1.5. Moving to our z-table, we first zero in on the row for positive 1.5, and then the column for 1.50, leading us to the probability of observing a z of less than 1.5 as approximately equal to 0.933. Bringing this back to the probability being greater than 1.5, we have that the probability of z greater than 1.5 is equal to 1 minus the probability of z less than 1.5. This gives us 1 minus 0.933, which is equal to 0.067. This allows us to finally return to the shoe store, where we can say that the probability of having a customer with a shoe size of greater than 13 inches is about 0.067. Hopefully all that switching from a specific distribution for shoe size to the standard normal via the z multiplier makes sense. This video began with us discussing the general concept of a normal random variable. We then specified some of the mathematical rules and equations that allow us to put these properties into a mathematical language. Finally, we discussed how to work with the normal distribution, particularly how to make use of the mathematical rules and symmetry of the standard normal together with a z-table to find probabilities for random normal variables. This video has just been a brief introduction to the topic of normal random variables. I encourage you to keep learning about them in other places on Chegg.